final spring scrimmage under your belts. Overall, what were your thoughts of the offense and the way, the progress your guys made this spring?
You know, I was just happy with a lot of guys, that just from the standpoint of we got better in terms of we built depth. We got guys playing different positions at receiver that, you know, we put them at this position, but they're learning this position. And I think that's huge when you're trying to build your depth up, because if you got somebody hurt, somebody gets banged up, somebody can move around, and you don't miss a beat. So I've been really pleased with that. For the most part, we've had a good spring in terms of injuries, staying injury-free. That's what a good spring's all about, you know, getting your work in, getting better, developing young guys, and staying healthy. And that's what we, you know, had a successful spring game because nobody really got hurt. So that was a good day.
Coach Morris has had a lot of good things to say about Ben Hicks and Rafe Peavy, who was here in the fall on your scout team, and then you brought in DJ Gillens in January. You're in the meeting rooms with him. You're looking at film with him. And DJ was limited, but you're out on the field with him. How do you evaluate the way the quarterbacks have done this spring?
I've been very proud of them all. They've all taken a leadership role in the team. I've pushed them to be encouragers, to have big body language, to encourage with a soft tongue, let me do the yelling and the screaming, and let those guys be the encouragers and getting the energy going. And they've done a heck of a job of that, man. Now, I just can't be more proud of my guys. From a standpoint of just how close they are. I mean, I got a close group, and it's fun being around them every day. Just hearing some of their parents talk after the spring game about how much fun they're having playing in the system, having fun every day in the meeting room. It's not like that everywhere, and they're really enjoying it. And so that made my day, just hearing that, just to know that we're doing things the right way here. And my guys are having fun because I'm having fun being around them. They bring the best out of me, and I'm trying to bring the best out of them. But we, you know, we're not going to name a starter or anything like that. Ben, you know, Ben was what you expected of Ben being in the system, now going on his third year. He had a really good spring, and the challenge to Ben is to not get complacent and to keep working, and that helps with competition. You know, and Ben saw Rafe progress throughout spring and how far he came from last fall. And Rafe did a heck of a job towards the end of spring of just understanding that we're a fast-paced tempo offense. We don't huddle up and run the ball a lot like his previous school, that we're trying to play as fast as we possibly can. We're trying to sling it around the yard, hand the ball off, carry out our fakes. And at first that was difficult for Rafe, but man, he came on so much through the last couple of weeks of the spring, and really impressed a lot of guys and a lot of coaches, a lot of players, and just his leadership ability is just you know second to none. You know, he's some guys refer to him as Rafe Tebow. You know, he's just such a good dude. You know, he's just a good guy. And it's fun to be around. And then DJ, you know, it was tough on DJ. All my guys are competitors. You know, DJ's a competitor. He wants to be out there. He got a lot of reps when it was just there's no D-line out there. We tried to get him as much as we possibly could. And he took his role awesome. He did an awesome job in the spring, knowing that he wouldn't be able to get a lot of reps on the field. He was behind, you know, the spring game wasn't just for show. He's behind every single day, getting every single rep at practice. And I think that speaks volumes for him as a leader, him as just a football player and a guy. Just, I can't do it right now, but I'm gonna go out there and get every single rep mentally that I possibly can. And he's drug a couple running backs out there that's been hurt with him. And they've gone through their steps. They've gone through, you know, kind of jogging through some routes and stuff like that. So. You know, just can't wait to get him out there and see what he can do. But from an overall group standpoint, I can't be more proud of my guys, just from the role of being leaders and being encouragers that we talk about every single day. I can't be more proud. I can't brag on them enough, man. I love those guys. Tell them every day I love them. I hope they love me back. I'm pretty sure they do, but. Man, we just have such a great room, and it'll be interesting, you know, who will compete for the job, who will end up winning it. It's going to take, we tell them all the time, everything counts. Going to class counts, not missing tutors counts, You know, and all of that counts, and obviously playing on the field, all that counts. So it'll be good. It'll be a good competition throughout summer and then throughout fall camp, and we'll look forward to playing the SMU Mustangs on game one.
Rafe had a bit of an advantage over DJ in the sense that he was here in the fall, so he's familiar with you and your team and his teammates and some of the basics of your offense. But on a week-to-week basis, he was learning the opponent's offense.
That's right.
Does he show up in January almost on equal footing then with DJ, significantly behind Ben?
You know, he had some terminology stuff down. But again, Rafe wasn't there day one of install, and he kind of was having to pick it up as he went terminology-wise. So it was tough on Rafe when he first got here because of that. He didn't start in my meeting day one install of fall camp. That didn't happen. So as he got here, he had to pick it up as he went. And but I think that it gave him a little bit more of a leg up because he was familiar with some terms, he was familiar with what we were trying to do in certain situations. And you saw him sometimes in the meeting go, oh, that's why we did that in the fall. And he's like, yeah, that's why we did that in the fall. So he was picking up on certain things as we went. But again, just to sit down in the spring and start day one install really helped all those guys, even Ben, to get the review and hear it for the third time. He gets stuff that he didn't normally get on a day-to-day basis.
When you look at the rest of this offense, you already had three or four running backs who you and the rest of the staff liked. Now it looks like you may have discovered one or two more, and you run primarily a one-back offense. Yeah. How do you and Coach Traylor and Coach Morris manage the egos, and are there enough carries to go around with this group?
Well, that's the million-dollar question. You know, how to get all of our playmakers on the field. It's something our offensive staff talked about actually last week. We named what we thought was our top six playmakers, and three of them are in the same room. So it's hard. It's hard to do that, but you got to find different ways of moving some guys around. Again, those guys that we're talking about have been in the system for a couple of years now, so we're hoping that they can pick up on different things and we can get them all on the field at the same time, because that's when you're most deadly, when you got your six-place playmakers on the field in a rotation and getting them in there and getting the next guy in there. So they're all going to stay happy. They're all about the team. They truly are. And I'm not just blowing smoke right there. Those guys in both rooms, even as a tight end from a tight end group, understand it's about the big picture, and everybody wants to win. I know Braden West in his first year, his true freshman year, man, he was so down just because he wants to win. He don't care how he win. He don't care how many touches he gets. He just wants to win. And I know all those guys feel the same way. But it's a challenge for us as coaches, but it's a good problem to have. I'd much rather have that problem than be trying to find a way to move with just one guy around and get him the ball all the time. But it's a good problem to have. And I know our quarterbacks enjoy it as well.
Speaking of those running backs, you've got a new running backs coach in Jeff Traylor. What does he add to this staff? How does he change the running game at all?
You know, he adds a wealth of knowledge. Coach Traylor's been a great coach for a long time. We're going to miss Coach Mathis. Coach Mel, we wish him well. He's going to do a great job at Marshall. But Coach Traylor's come in here and done a heck of a job. I think of building relationships with the guys more than anything. That was kind of his goal. He knew those guys were really close to Coach Mathis, and he took it and did it the right way. And I think he's really developed a relationship with those guys. But he brings a lot of knowledge. Again, he's been there, done that, a lot of different places. But really and truly building what he built at Gilmer. It speaks volumes for him as a guy, but he's also, man, he's just, you know, he's one of the older heads now in our meeting room from an offensive staff, and he even said that to me last night. He calls us kids, me, Coach Fry, Coach Step, but we have a good time. You know, he's a great guy. We're gonna miss Coach Mathis, but Coach Traylor's been great ever since he got here. He's really just bought into what we've done. He's kind of took a step back and just learned. But man, learn the offense and everything like that, and learn kind of the way we do things. But it's going to be great having him here and helping those running backs out this year.
Do you automatically get first dibs on any player coming out of Marshall now?
We better. I'll go down there and kick Coach Mathis' butt.
All right, so we talk about the quarterbacks, we talk about the running backs. Obviously, none of that's going to be effective unless the offensive line works out. and you've got a couple new faces up there as well. You should be getting Chad Persley back.
Mm-hmm.
Bryce Wild's got a lot of first-team reps at right tackle. Jerry got hurt at the end of spring, but I gather we'll be back in the fall. When you look at that group, I know you always talk about wanting to have depth and be able to go two deep or three deep even, but when you look at that group, how does it compare to last year's offensive line?
I'm really excited about them, honestly. Getting Chad back will really help us move a couple guys around, and it's just up to us as coaches to find the right pieces to the puzzle. To get five guys out there that are the best guys, again, trying to find who's the best five, get them in there, plug them in there, because that's when you're most dangerous. And then build some continuity between those guys, I think, is the most important thing. Obviously, getting Chad back, being able to move Nick Nator around a little bit. He's a very versatile guy. He's really come along. I'm really proud of him. And then having Evan as your leader inside, man, I mean, we're blessed. I'm telling you right now, because he makes us go. Those guys don't get a whole lot of notoriety, but, man, I'm telling you right now, those guys are incredible. With what they do up front, and I can't brag on those guys enough. Everybody wants to talk about receivers, the running backs, the tight ends, the quarterbacks, but, man, those are the guys make it all go. And being an ex-quarterback, I know I've said this before, being an ex-quarterback, man, I have a genuine appreciation for those guys and what they do on a day-to-day basis. But, again, bringing in a couple freshmen that are going to help build some depth, counting on a couple of those guys to come in here and be ready to play. And But we feel like we have a good nucleus of guys that's going to be able to help us, and really be really good up front. I'm not worried about those guys one bit. Coach Fry, again, I've said this before, I'm biased, but I think he's one of the best coaches in the country. And from a scheme standpoint, and from a relationship standpoint, those guys love him. And they know that he knows what it takes to get them to the next level, because he's played at a high level in the NFL. So. Those guys are going to be great. I'm really excited about what we got for this 2017 season.
You mentioned Nick Nator, who filled in last year at tackle when Chad Persley got hurt. Mm-hmm. But he was a guard before the year before. Is he better suited to guard, and if so, why? Or was it just a matter of that's the way the numbers work out?
Yeah, again, I think we're just trying to find our best five. And if he's one of our best five, which he is, just finding the best place for him to play. Again, he did a heck of a job last year filling in for Chad. I think he's probably more suited for a tackle or guard. I mean, it's hard to say. I mean, right tackle on the other side away from Chad, or if Bryce continues to develop and Bryce is that steady Eddie guy at right tackle, and we can put Nick inside. Again, that's putting our best five guys out there. Nick's very versatile, like I said. He can play inside, he can play outside. But again, just building continuity when we get Chad back in there, building some continuity inside and on the offensive line will really help us become a strong team.
Like you said, everybody talks about quarterbacks and receivers and running backs. And so when you look at your receivers, how surprised are you that number 16 is coming back for one more year? Did you think he was gone?
I didn't. I thought he was going to come back. I thought that he trusts us as coaches. And I think that Courtland had a couple things. Just talking to some pro scouts, he had a few things he needed to work on. And I think that by him coming back, I think he's a no doubt first round guy next year. If he'll continue to develop, and that's one thing Courtland has challenged himself to do is be a great player, not just a good player. And he wants that first round. He wants all-conference. He wants first-team All-America. He wants all that. And you see him at practice because he slips down on a route or something. He wants to be perfect. He's striving for perfection. And he truly is trying to be the best receiver in the country. Whereas this year coming out, you know, there was a bunch of mock drafts and everything where they had him, you know, four, five, or six guy going in the draft. And I think this year he's on a mission. He's a man on a mission to prove to everybody he's the best wide out in the country. And he's got all the physical tools to do that. What I've been most proud with Courtland this spring is the fact that he's taken on a leadership role. He's really understood who he is as a person, and that the young guys look up to him, and he's really come on and helped encourage, helped lead. When guys are screwing up, he goes over there and gets them right. And so that's what I've been most proud of with Courtland this spring. He hasn't got a whole lot of reps and team stuff because, again, we know what he can do. But from an individual standpoint, really working on this craft, mastering his craft, we say, and took about three things that we felt like he really needed to work on that would help him at the next level, and really worked on those things and got better. But again, he strives for perfection. He wants to be the best receiver in the country, hands down, by far. And again, he's a man on a mission, and I think he's well on his way to proving that this year.
You talked about his relationship with some of those young guys. One of those young guys is James Prochet, who mm-hmm. became a very nice number two last year. Going into his second year of getting on the field and playing for you guys, how do you anticipate James being different this year?
I honestly think that James is maturing. Just he's going from a boy to a man, and to see him develop that way, I've been really proud with James. Just loving the game and coming out every single day and competing and working. And whereas the past, you know, when he had the red shirt, and even some last year, he would get in these moods where you didn't want to be around James. And we've talked about this with him. And man, he's matured so much, and going into his third year. I can't be more proud of James, just his work ethic, him coming to work every day. Again, he sees Courtland. He knows that all those guys should know, we're gonna have a lot of pro scouts around here this next year, a lot. And if they want to play at the next level, you know, those pro scouts aren't waiting for you to be draft eligible to see if you're a guy or not. They're making their notes right now as a young guy and trying to figure out if you're a guy they're going to want to look at in the future. So just been really proud of him, man, developing into a man and really bringing some of those other guys along as well with him.
Another name that's come up a lot this spring is Trey Quinn, who transferred in. Everybody knows he played at LSU. The little bit that we've watched in practice, you can tell he's obviously very fast. But beyond his LSU pedigree and his pure 40-yard dash time, what kind of receiver is he?
Man, he's a guy that every one of those kids look up to. Every one of those guys look up to him. Again, he's played at a high level. He's played in the SEC. He's a technician. He does everything we ask him to do and more, but he's just got this presence about him. It's hard to describe, but you know, you hear a lot of coaches talk about that it factor. You know, Trey has it. Whatever it is, you get around Trey and you see him, and how he carries himself, his presence. You know, Trey wants to be great, and there's no doubt about that, and he's on a mission as well. But just from a standpoint of, you know, we needed him and Courtland to kind of pick up the pace with leadership and all that. I think Trey is a guy, he's not going to say a lot. He's not going to be a hoorah guy, you know, and hoot and holler. But he's a guy that is a leader with his work ethic and how he plays. And those kids really respect him in that room. And as well, I'm glad we have Trey here. Obviously, we recruited him to Clemson. He should have went to Clemson to start with, but it's worked out great because now he's got 2 years left to play, and he's in the right system. He's in a system that can showcase his talent, and couldn't be more proud of how he's come in here and not been this guy that, you know, look at me and I'm an SEC guy playing here. No, he hadn't done any of that. He's been just a solid guy, a solid presence in that room that I think all those guys like being around.
And then finally, when you look at tight ends, Jeremiah Gaines has graduated. You get Raymond Epps over from Arizona State. And it looks like a different group. When he signed Ryan Becker, there were some that thought Ryan Becker might grow into a tackle. And you've split him out wide some in spring. Is that because of the presence of Raymond Epps, or is that because of Ryan's development on his own? And then you got Corey Rao in the mix, and you've got Jordan Siebert, who used to be a quarterback. How do you see the tight end rotation shaking out in the fall?
Don't forget Mitchell Kaufman, too.
And Mitchell Kaufman.
Mitchell's played a lot of ball for us. You know, it's great having Raymond here. I mean, we hit a home run with him, not from a football standpoint, but from the kind of man he is. He's an unbelievable character kid. Every one of our kids absolutely love Ray. But also from a standpoint of he's also played at a high level in the Pac-12, and getting him in here and understanding, kind of had a good familiarity with our offense and what we were trying to do. They did a lot of things like we do at Arizona State. And so he's kind of come in and hadn't missed a beat. But been really proud with that group. I think Coach Gunn has done a great job with those guys, bringing them along. I think Coach Gunn has a lot of deserves a lot of credit with the way Becker's come on. Becker, like you said, we've been able to split him out, put him in the backfield. We thought he was going to grow into a tackle, but if you just saw the last scrimmage, not the spring game, but the scrimmage before, man, he took off on a run, and I was like, whoa, where'd that come from? So the guy can really run. And with Ray in there really developing those guys and helping out, Mitchell missed some time in the spring with injury. Can't wait to get him back healthy because, again, he's played a lot of ball for us. And Corey Rowell obviously catching the game winner in the spring game was huge. Confidence builder for him going into the summer, and I'm proud of him as well. But we got some really good tight ends in that room, and I'm really excited about the future with those guys because it's – we tell them all the time they're what makes our offense go. And you know, when you go out recruiting and you talk about the most important guy we recruit is quarterback, the second most important guy we recruit is the tight end, because that's what makes this offense go. And I think we got 4 to 5 good ones that's really going to help us out this year, and it's really exciting because in years past we've had some freshmen, and we've had a Jeremiah who was a receiver transfer or receiver converted into a tight end. And now we feel like we've got, you know, 3 or 4 or 5 really good, solid tight end type guys that we're going to go in the 2017 season with a lot of depth at that position, which we haven't had in the past. So really excited about those guys.
All right, like you said, the receivers and running backs get all the headlines along with quarterbacks. Why is it the tight end that makes this offense go?
They have to be able to block. They got to be able to attach as a tight end, true tight end. They got to be able to split out as a receiver. Again, I don't think there's any secret that we want to stay in 11 personnel. We don't want to switch. Again, if you're going to try to play fast, you got to stay in one personnel. You can't change to 10. You can't go to 20. You got to stay in 11 personnel. And so that's why that's most important. Again, it's also important for us as coaches to be able to find that guy. Because if you find a receiver, a big, long receiver that you think can put on some weight, maybe he can do it, but is he going to stick his face in the fan? Is it a high school linebacker, Mitchell Kaufman? Is it an offensive lineman like Ryan Becker that is very athletic but maybe not be able to hold 270, 280 pounds? So it's kind of a projected position that we have to do a good job in as coaches recruiting that position as well. But they also have to be smart. They can't be dumb. They got to be able to motion around and line up in different situations and know where to be on certain play calls. And again, all those guys have done a tremendous job of that, learning the system. You know, honestly and truly, behind the quarterback, those guys probably know the offense better than anybody because of what they have to do. They have to play receiver, they have to play fullback, they have to play tight end. And so they got to do a lot of individual work with offensive line. They got to do a lot of individual work with receivers. And then Coach Gunn has to do his own individual work as a fullback type guy. And so those guys have really worked hard, and can't wait to see how they progress throughout summer and fall camp as well.